everybody, and welcome to St Paul's and our Summer Sunday. I'm Debbie, and Ollie and I are going to be leading the service today. And we're going to look all about lost things. So,
did someone say lost?
Yeah, I did.
Hi there.
Hi.
Hi.
Who are you?
Who are you?
I'm pretty sure I should be asking the questions.
Is that right?
I think so.
Well, my name is Charlie. Charlie Snaplin.
Hi, Charlie Snaplin. Nice to meet you.
Nice to meet you.
I'm Debbie.
Lovely to meet you, Debbie.
Lovely to meet you too. Can I help you?
Yes. Well, the truth is, I'm a little bit lost.
Really? I'd never have guessed.
Yes, I lost my way a little bit. I was looking for something. I've had a bit of a bad week, actually, with losing things.
Oh,
look,
no.
I've lost one of my teeth, right at the back. Have a look. But seriously, I have had a bad week. I was looking for my face mask, which I lost. So I couldn't do my shopping this week. I'm so hungry.
Actually, yes. I found this. Is that it?
That is it. That's my face mask.
Oh, here you go then.
Oh, thank you so much. Thank you. Well, right, I best I'll be off to the shops to get some food.
Enjoy.
Bye.
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 Thanks, Charlie. Well, actually, that fits in really nicely with our theme this week of lost things. And specifically, we're going to look about the prodigal son in Luke 15, which is in a chapter with stories all about lost things. So let's first of all pray, let's dedicate this time to God, and then we're going to go to Ollie, who's going to read it for us. Father, I thank you that even though we can't meet in person, we can meet together online and still experience you and hear what you have to say to us. Help us to be open to what you are saying, and please bless this time together. Amen.
So I'm reading from Luke chapter 15 and from verse 11 till the end of the chapter. And this is the parable of the lost son. Jesus continued, "There was a man who had two sons. The younger one said to his father, 'Father, give me my share of the estate.' So he divided his property between them. Not long after that, the younger son got together all he had and set off for a distant country. And there he squandered his wealth on wild living. After he had spent everything, there was a severe famine in that whole country, and he began to be in need. So he went and hired himself out to a citizen of that country, who sent him to his fields to feed the pigs. He longed to fill his stomach with the pods that the pigs were eating. That's how hungry he was. But no one gave him anything. When he came to his senses, he said, 'How many of my father's hired men have food to spare? And here I am, starving to death. I will set out and go back to my father and say to him, Father, I have sinned against heaven and against you. I'm no longer worthy to be called your son. Make me like one of your hired men.' So he got up and went back to his father. But while he was still a long way off, his father saw him and, filled with compassion for him, ran to his son. He threw his arms around him and he kissed him. The son said to him, 'Father, I've sinned against heaven and against you. I'm no longer worthy to be called your son.' But the father said to his servants, 'Quick, bring the best robe and put it on him. Put a ring on his finger and sandals on his feet. Bring the fattened calf and kill it. Let's have a feast and celebrate, for this son of mine was dead and is alive again. He was lost and is found.' So they began to celebrate. Meanwhile, the older son was in the field. When he came near the house, he heard music and dancing. So he called out to one of the servants and asked him what was going on. 'Oh, your brother's come home,' he replied. 'And your father's killed the fattened calf because, well, He's back safe and sound. The older brother became angry and refused to go in. So his father went out and pleaded with him. But he answered his father, "Look, all these years I've been slaving for you and never disobeyed your orders. Yet you never gave me even a young goat so I could celebrate with my friends. But when this son of yours, who squandered your property with prostitutes, comes home, what do? You kill the fattened calf for him." "My son," the father said, "you are always with me and everything I have is yours. But we had to celebrate and be glad because this brother of yours was dead and is alive again. He was lost and is found."
Stories of the Bible, the Prodigal Son. This is Jesus.
Heyo!
Who is the Son of God and the Savior of the world. While Jesus was on earth, he taught everyone about God's love. He healed many people from their sickness, performed many miracles like calming storms, and even raised people from the dead. Jesus taught everyone about God's love. All kinds of people would come to hear Jesus speak, including tax collectors and people who made bad choices. This made the Pharisees and Jewish leaders mad.
Ugh, yuck.
They didn't think that Jesus should be around these kind of people. So Jesus told them this story. A man had two sons. The younger son told his father,
"Excuse me?
I want my share of your estate now, before you die."
"Okay."
So his father agreed and gave his son his inheritance.
Woohoo!
A few days later, this younger son packed all his belongings.
"See ya!"
And moved to a distant land. And there he wasted all his money in wild living.
Huh?
About the time his money ran out, a great famine swept over the land.
Aw, man!
And he began to starve.
Hey, you!
He convinced a local farmer to hire him.
Dinko!
And the man sent him into his fields to feed the pigs. The young man became so hungry that even the food he was feeding the pigs looked good to him. But no one gave him anything. Finally, he said to himself, "At home, even the servants have food enough to spare. And here I'm dying of hunger.
I know.
I will go home to my father and apologize and ask him to take me on as a servant." So he returned home to his father. And while he was still a long way off, his father saw him coming. Filled with love and compassion, he ran to his son.
"Son!"
His son said to him, "Father, I have sinned against both heaven and you, and I am no longer worthy of being called your son." But his father said to the servants, "Quick, bring the finest robe in the house and put it on him. Get a ring for his finger and sandals for his feet, and kill the calf we have been fattening. We must celebrate with a feast, for this son of mine was dead and now has returned to life. He was lost, but now he is found." So the party began. Meanwhile, the older son was in the fields working. When he returned home, he heard music and dancing in the house.
"Huh? Hey, you!"
And he asked one of the servants what was going on. "Your brother is back," he was told, "and your father has killed the fattened calf. We are celebrating because of his safe return."
"Woohoo! All right! Party time! All right! Yahoo!"
The older brother was angry and wouldn't go in. His father came out and begged him.
"Oh, man."
But he replied, "All these years I've slaved for you and never once refused to do a single thing you told me to. And in all that time, you never gave me even one young goat for a feast with my friends. Yet when this son of yours comes back after wasting your money, you celebrate by giving him a great feast." His father said to him, Look, dear son, you have always stayed by me, and everything I have is yours. We had to celebrate this happy day, for your brother was dead and has come back to life. He was lost, but now he is found.
So Debbie and I are going to share the thought section of the service, or the preach, if you like. And that's not just so we can prove that we love each other and we can work together. No, it's because we actually relate to different brothers in the story. And I relate to the younger brother, particularly, the one that ran away from home. I mean, I never really ran away from home. I did once because my mum wouldn't give me any Wotsits when I wanted Wotsits as a child. So I ran away from home to my gran's house. But I've never really done anything particularly bad or squandered my wealth or anything in wild living. And I don't think that's necessarily the point of the story, that he was, this younger brother was a really, really bad person. I've never really hurt anyone, as far as I know, seriously, other than my brother, maybe in play fights. And the worst thing I've ever done is maybe stolen some sweets. And maybe you're like me, maybe you have, the worst thing you've ever done is stolen some sweets from the pick and mix in Woolworths. God rest your soul, Woolworths. Or from a shop or something like that, or you've stolen something minimal. Or maybe you've done some really bad stuff and you relate to the younger brother in a different way. But the reason that I relate to the younger brother is because I think his problem was that he wanted recognition, okay? He was the youngest in the family, all right? I'm not. But he was the youngest in the family and he wasn't supposed to get any inheritance, and maybe he felt like he was being overlooked the whole time, and he wanted to make something of himself. He ran away, he took what he wanted from his family, and he ran away to distant land to make a name for himself and to enjoy his life, because he thought he could enjoy his life by doing what he wanted away from his family. And I'm like that sometimes. I relate to that because I want recognition. I want to be remembered. I want to be known. I want to make something of this life for me. And I want to get things. I want to experience things. I want to do some cool stuff in my life. And sometimes that does push me away from God. If the father in the story represents God, then that does push me away from God. It does mean I run away from the way that God would like me to live, to be humble, and to serve others and to put others first, and to sacrifice things that I want in order to live for God. And sometimes I look around me and I think, oh my gosh, I'm far away from home. I've run all this way and I'm in a mess. And it's only when we realise and we look around ourselves at the mess we've created that we feel the need for God. Sometimes we feel the need to come home. And maybe that's like you, okay? Maybe you have done some really bad stuff, and you've wasted gifts that you were given, and you look around yourself and you say, I'm in a mess, and you need to run home to God. Or maybe, like me, you don't necessarily think you're a bad person, but you have been selfish in that you've wanted recognition, you've wanted to live life your way. And that's just as problematic for our relationship with God as doing bad stuff. And so if that's you, friends, let me encourage you, run home. Run home. Because before you even get close, God will run out to meet you. So if that is you, why don't you pray with me now, and just, you can just agree with the words in your head and say them to God. Father God, I know that I've made a mistake, and I know that sometimes I run away in order to be selfish and to get the things that I want, and I don't necessarily live in the way that you've asked me to. Maybe I've done bad things and I've made a mess, or maybe I'm just far from you and I feel distant. I want to run home, God. I want to run back to you. Meet me on the road, and remind me of my place, my rightful place, my true place by your side. Amen.
So Ollie's looked at the younger son who has run away from home, and it is going to be my job to look at the older one who stays home and ticks the boxes. Now, when I was younger in school, in primary school, we used to have a Pupil of the Week award. Now, this was a big deal amongst us. I can't even remember what you got as a prize, but you got to stand at the front of assembly on a Friday and you would be applauded and recognised by the whole school for how you have won Pupil of the Week that week. It only got given to one person each week. Now, I was really good at school. I was a tick the boxes kind of girl. I would do everything the teacher said. I would go to the rules. I would stick with them. I would very rarely break them. And yet I never got Pupil of the Week. It was always the kids who had done one thing right in the week. They had maybe been good for 5 minutes and the rest of the week had been a complete disaster. However, because of those 5 minutes, they were recognised for being good and being Pupil of the Week. Now, I thought that was really unfair, that I would be good all week and no one would ever recognise me, yet someone would be good for 5 minutes and they would get the prize. And I wonder if that's a little bit how this brother felt. He had ticked the boxes, he had stayed at home, he had worked as a slave, as he put it, and yet his dad supposedly had never recognised everything he had done. Yet his brother, who had gone off, squandered his money, been a complete disaster, comes home and this dad throws a massive party for him. And he was jealous and felt it was really unfair. However, on closer inspection, maybe this probably should have been called the two lost sons. Because it turns out you can be lost even if you're still at home. This brother is the less obvious sinner. His younger brother has run away. The whole town knows about it. It's very obvious what he has done. The older brother looks like the one who hasn't sinned, who has stayed at home, has worked the farm, has done everything his father has ever asked him to do. However, in not going to this party, in standing outside and refusing to go in, he's humiliating his dad in front of the whole community that's there to celebrate his brother's return. He could have the most amazing relationship with this generous dad who loves him, who wants to get to know him. Yet all those years of working on the farm, he sees himself as a slave. This is what he says. He says, "Look, all these years I've been slaving for you and never disobeyed your orders, yet you never even gave me a young goat so I could celebrate with my friends. But when this son of yours, who has squandered your property with prostitutes, comes home, you kill the fattened calf for him. He has worked, seemingly, as a slave on this farm. He hasn't got a relationship with his dad that is father and son. He sees it as master and slave. He's done all the right things, yet he doesn't really know his dad. And actually, maybe today that's you. You don't have to run away to be lost from God. But actually, what God wants to say is he wants you to come into that party. You might be someone who has always attended church, always read your Bible, always prays, ticks the boxes like I did at school because that is what is asked of you. Yet actually, you don't know God, you don't know Jesus, you don't really know the love and have that relationship with him that you could have. Because you have seen it as a ticking the boxes, we do what we do because that's what we have to do to call ourselves a Christian. Whereas actually, yes, God calls for obedience, but he wants a relationship with you. He loves you and he wants to get to know you. Now, how does this dad respond? He could chuck his son out. He could be so angry for humiliating him in front of the whole community by refusing to come to this party. He could discipline him. He would have a right to do so within this culture. But actually, he does the opposite. He goes out, he humbles himself in front of the whole community to plead with his son to come to this party. And he says this, "My son, you are always with me and everything I have is yours. But we had to celebrate and be glad because this brother of yours was dead and is alive again. He was lost and is found." Maybe you're the first son. Maybe you have run away from God. You have squandered your money, maybe literally, maybe not speaking, but you don't know him and you need to come running back home. But actually, maybe you're the second son. Maybe for all appearances, you are doing the right thing. You have gone to church, you have read your Bible, you look like a good Christian, whatever that might look like. But you don't really know God. It doesn't come from a love for God and knowing his love for you. It comes from a ticking the boxes. These are the rules I have to live by. And the love and the relationship isn't there. God has humbled himself for you. He came down, he died on that cross for you. You might have heard this 1,000 times before. If you've been coming to church and ticking those boxes, you probably have heard it 1,000 times before. But if you don't really know that that is the God that loves you and have that relationship with him, why don't you come to that party? He's come out, he has humbled himself, he has left the banqueting table to come out of that party, to go to you who's standing outside refusing to go in because you've ticked the boxes and why isn't this party for me? And he's come out and he is pleading with you to join the party, to restore your relationship with him. He's done all the work. All you have to do is step into that room and start getting to know him and his love for you. I think sometimes, for me in particular, sometimes it feels like my relationship with God should look like someone else's. It should look like Ollie's relationship with God. It should. Why doesn't it look like the people that stand up and preach at the front of church? Why doesn't it look like the person next door? But actually, God has made us all unique. And because of who he is and because of who we are, our relationships with God will look a little bit different. And that's okay. He will have gifted us slightly different gifts. He will probably speak to us in slightly different ways because he knows our character. And if you look at this story, he responds to both boys in love, but differently. So actually the way he loves might look a bit different, but the love that's behind it is the same. It's just as deep. He loves both sons as much as each other, yet his responses to both of them are different because he knows who they are and he wants to get to know them more and he wants them to know him. So if your relationship does look a little bit different, don't be stressed out by that. Don't be jealous. Don't not want to go to the party because why is that party for someone else and it should be for me? You've never thrown me a party. God's there saying, I love you. Everything I have is yours. If you want a party, I'll throw you a party. Actually, what I want to do is get to know you and I want to have a relationship with you. So today, just have a think. Where do I fit into that parable? And what is God calling me for?
So what we wanted to do was do some prayer stations in the home. Some kind of together reflective activities that we can do together if you're with people or if you're on your own that you can do on your own, just to help us pray and spend time in God's presence. So I'm going to explain the three different stations that we've come up with. They're really, really simple. Hopefully they'll be using things that you can find at home. And then you can pause the video, get all the stuff you need, and then there'll be a worship song at the end of this little section, just so you can take time working through the stations and using them to spend time in God's presence. And the first station is called Spaghetti Snap. So what you need for this one is a glass of water and some spaghetti. And lockdown has been a tense time for us, and I can feel myself having more tension in me, more stress than I normally would. And I'm sure many of you are the same. And so what you want to do is during the spaghetti snap is take some spaghetti and just spend some time reflecting on what is it that is making you tense and making you stressed, and lay that before God. And then when you do, you can snap the spaghetti, or if you want, you can just get angry and snap it up. And it's just a way to say, God, break that tension in me, break the stress that I'm going through. And then take some more spaghetti. Okay, do all this prayerfully, friends, in the presence of the Lord. And then place that spaghetti in some water and put that where you can see it. And then during the day, just whenever you see that, just pray, God, soak me in your presence. Help me to not be brittle and to snap easily, but fill me with love and goodness. And you'll find that slowly the spaghetti starts to absorb some of the water and doesn't stay quite as tense and rigid. So do that as a way to remember that you need to soak in God's presence during the day. Okay, so the second station is called In the Palm of My Hand. And in Isaiah 49 verse 16, the Lord says, "See, I will not forget you. I have engraved you on the palm of my hand." And so what you want to do is take a piece of paper and a pen
and just spend some time drawing around your hand. And as you do, you can thank God that your name is engraved on the palm of his hand, that he doesn't forget you, even when it feels like he might have done or he might be far away, that God promises that God will never forget you. And you can thank God for that and the comfort that that brings. And then once you've drawn around your hand, like so, then you can write names of people that you want to remember before the Lord in the hand. So you might write your mum and dad and members of your family. You might write friends. At school, I'm writing my teddy because I just want to thank God for my teddy. You might write friends at school. You might write work colleagues. You can fill that hand with names that you want to remember before the Lord and pray for them and pray that God's blessing would be upon them. Okay, and the third station is just a simple object reflection station. And I'm going to use a candle, but you can use any object that you want. A candle's really good because there's a lot in the Bible about Jesus being the light of the world. And there's something about lighting a candle which is reflective and helps me, leads me into prayer. But it doesn't have to be a candle if you haven't got any. You could use a bunch of flowers, or you could just look out the window. But what you want to do is find something that you can use, an object that you can use to reflect on. And ask the question, God, how are you like this object? What does this object say about you? Okay, and lead you into some reflection on God's character. And then also say, God, just speak to me, and spend some time sitting silently, reflecting, allowing God to speak to you. And for that, I'm just going to use a candle. So those are our three stations. So why don't you pause the video, get the bits and pieces that you need, set the stations up, and then as the worship song plays, you can work through those stations and use them if they help you to reflect on God and to lead you into God's presence. Do them as a family or as a household, or do them on your own, and know that the rest of the church are doing it with you. Thank you.
Good morning, St. Paul's. Tracy and I are excited to share some news on behalf of the MHT and leadership. We live in exceptional times, and many people have suffered loss and are anxious or uncertain about their futures. Businesses and the economy are suffering the effects of the global pandemic. The church has been neither inactive nor powerless during this period. We've continued to reach out to our local communities, assisting individuals and families wherever possible. We plan to resume our services in church on the 6th of September, where we can once again gather together corporately. In preparation for that date, on the 23rd of August, we are calling the church to join together to pray, to affect the spiritual atmosphere over the city. And to assist with that, we've arranged three distinct events. The first is at 10:30 on August the 23rd. There's a prayer walk starting at St. Paul's that guides people around the city praying in significant locations. To encourage families to join us, we've included an interactive quiz for both children and teenagers. If they complete the quiz, we intend to give out some prizes. The whole walk will finish at Fort Royal Hill, where, if you wish, you can bring a picnic and enjoy a picnic together. Of course, we want everybody to observe social distancing. At that point in time, if you finish that quiz, we will give out some prizes. If you haven't, don't worry. You can do part of the walk or continue it on another occasion. The second is the church will be open for a prayer service from 10:30 that will be conducted according to the government guidelines. And finally, if you're unable to join us in the walk on that day or attend the service, then there will be an online prayer guide that you can take part in.
Arising from the prayer sessions since March, we have had two words, one from Matthew's Gospel about building on the rock, not sand, and the second from Nehemiah 3, where everyone was involved in rebuilding the city. And we at St. Paul's can all be involved in rebuilding the city spiritually. There was opposition in Nehemiah. As Sambalat spoke, he said, "Do they actually think they can make something of stones from a rubbish heap and charred ones at that?" Do we believe we can make stones out of charred remains? We do. We believe when we pray, we call into being that which is unseen. And we know that every move of God throughout history has started with prayer. So join with us and pray for the Holy Spirit to hover over our city and bring forth life. And again, this is the response of Nehemiah. "Don't be afraid of the enemy." Is that hopelessness? Is that your situation stops you from coming to pray? Have you got preconceived ideas? Prayer works. Remember the Lord, who is great and glorious, and fight for your brothers, your sons, your daughters, your wives, and your homes. And when our enemies heard that we knew of their plans and that God had frustrated them, we all return to our work on the wall.
So come along on the 23rd of August and let's pray. Let's contend and fight for our neighbours, our families, our friends and our wives and our cities. We look forward to seeing you on the 23rd, 10:30 at St. Paul's. God bless you all.
So that concludes our service for this week. We hope you found it helpful. We hope you've connected with God through these prayer stations and thoughts that we have shared. Just remember, wherever you find yourself this week, God wants you home. Home is where you should be. So run home and enjoy that personal relationship that you can have with God that will look a bit different to everyone else's, but it's that personal, intimate relationship that you can have with Him. God bless, and we'll see you next week.